Thank you. Thank you all for being here with us this evening for this program, which is not only made of music, as all concerts are, but also kind of about music and about music's power, or maybe powers. I think we're all here because we love it and we need it, maybe like a narcotic sometimes, and because it takes us places that are so sublime and scary and different from the rest of our lives that we can't get that fix anywhere else. So this program, what binds together the pieces of music by composers stretching across four centuries, is that each of these pieces of music is in some way an exploration of music's power. Sometimes it's pure praise, sometimes it looks at music with a slightly suspicious, askance eye and wonders if something that is so powerful and so seductive can really be doing us good, or if it might be leading us off some cliff, who knows. So for this next piece, I will save my spoken introductions to the top of each half. So the next few pieces you'll be hearing first is my own composition, Tony Ending the Life, which is a kind of dramatic scena for voice and ensemble being performed tonight in a piano reduction. James Merrill, a great American poet who passed away in the mid-1990s of AIDS, was both a kind of prophet of global warming and a great love poet. And his final poems do this mysterious thing where they equate what's happening to our world and what was happening to his own body as he got sicker and sicker. And this piece is a kind of bitter elegy for a friend who had lived quite an aesthetic, he'd lived as an aesthete in Greece and was himself dying of the same disease. And so this is Merrill looking at where a life in art might lead you. And after that piece, we'll hear Stravinsky's three songs from Shakespeare, which take the songs, which are interposed as songs in Shakespeare's plays, and sets them to the wonderful, weird, unpredictable music of his later period, where some people say that every note sounds wrong. I think they're all right. And we'll close out the first half with the first great aria from the first great opera, Possente Spirito, from Monteverdi's L'Orfeo. This, of course, is Orpheus's successful entreaty to Hades to let him in. So with that, please welcome our performers for Tony Ending the Life.
Receives with pleasure, with pleasure. Oh.
Welcome back to the courageous among you. It was most of you, actually, who survived. On the second half, we begin with Harrison Birtwistle's Orpheus elegies. Birtwistle is a mysterious, somewhat reclusive, very wonderful British composer who is still with us. And in the 80s, he wrote a colossal opera called The Mask of Orpheus, which requires electronics and millions of dollars, practically, of stage machinery. But we're very lucky that he also wrote these very intimate pieces for singer, either countertenor or mezzo-soprano, oboe, and harp, which, to my mind, kind of occupy the atmosphere of the underworld right after Orpheus has disappeared. So they're quite dark and they're quite mysterious. I hope you enjoy them. We move from them to my own piece, The Orphic Moment, which is a pretty twisted reading. Some of you have read the text and you're like, what's wrong with this guy? Please keep him at arm's length. It's a reading of the few seconds before Orpheus turns around, losing Eurydice forever. So the piece is really like a 16 or 17 minute expansion, slow-mo refraction of those few seconds. And my take on it, which I think is valid even for the myth that we all know, is that Orpheus is not just a nice guy who turns around to see if Eurydice is there because of some momentary impulse, but because as the ultimate musician, he knows that death, loss, is actually the most fruitful thing for music. The first time Eurydice died, he wrote the greatest music ever, and the second time she dies, he knows he's going to write even greater music. So he sort of manipulatively enjoys it. So, and we move from that to Franz Schubert, who is probably even darker than Orphic Moment. In this piece, Der Leiermann, in which the speaker of the poem, who seems to be a stand-in for a young musician, song composer, sees an old man playing a kind of an old organ grinder in the icy Austrian streets and has this terrifying moment of identification. Is that how I'm going to end up? Are you going to end up playing my songs on your hurdy-gurdy? I just want to note that I am here as a kind of security blanket for the musicians in the next group, but I really won't be doing much conducting because they've done such a spectacular job putting together this very challenging music. So, without further ado, please welcome Andrew, Elisa, and Lindsay for Orpheus Elegies. Thank you.
Thank you. So